Hallelujah to God. For thine,
yes, Lord,
is the kingdom and the power. Give it to him. And the glory forever. Everybody lift your voice and tell the Lord,
for thine
is the
kingdom
and the power and the power and the glory forever. It is so.
Amen.
Hallelujah to God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
God.
He's worthy of all of our praise today.
Hallelujah.
I said he's worthy of all of our praise today.
Mighty God.
I'm not trying to be facetious. Not even trying to be rhetorical, but just turn to somebody and ask them, what did you come here for? I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but turn to them and say, I came to give God the glory.
I came to give God glory.
You can't say it and not do it.
Yes, God.
If that's what you really came here for, if you didn't come to see anybody, you didn't come to get a hookup, you didn't come to show off your clothes, if you really came to give him glory, then you can't say it and not do it. For thine, tell him,
is the
kingdom
and the power. Yes. Jesus, we will not manufacture, we will not work up anything from a pure place in your heart. Give him glory from the real place that you've lived. Give him glory in the name of Jesus. Out of your experience, bless him here. Out of what you've been through this week, somebody tell God, thank you. Hallelujah. God bless your hearts. I am convinced that from the rising of the sun until the going down of the same, the name of our God is to be praised. I am convinced that no matter what happens at the dawning of a day, and no matter what happens at the end of the day, our God is worthy to be praised. You could wake up happy and go to bed sad, but he's still worthy of the praise. You can face things at noon that you didn't expect to happen to you, but God is still worthy of the praise. I'm trying to tell you, beloved, we are without excuse. No matter what happens during the course of the day, our God is still worthy. I need somebody to shout, still worthy. Just look at somebody and tell them, things have happened in my life since I've seen you last, but God is still worthy of praise. Things have transpired in my life over the last 24 hours, but God is still worthy of praise. All the news I heard this week wasn't good news, but he's still worthy of the praise. Yes, sir. Don't have everything I want, but I get everything I need, and he's still worthy. Oh, Shayamaha. Oh, somebody's getting set up for a miracle here. Because wherever you create an atmosphere of praise, that's the same atmosphere that miracles are performed in. Hallelujah. Pastor Rogers, this has been one of the darkest seasons of my life. But I need you to understand that every single day begins in the dark. You don't hear what I say. I said every single day begins in the dark. And you're going to have to learn how to praise your way through the dark into the light, because the darkest hour is just before the break of day. And I need somebody to know you're on the brink of a breakthrough here. If you can just open your mouth and tell them thank you. You gotta thank him for what you haven't seen yet. You gotta thank him for what you haven't seen yet. Because just because you haven't seen it does not mean it does not exist. Your healing is already in the room. Oh, shut up. It's just waiting on you to manifest. My God, in here today. Look at somebody and tell them, call it into existence. Y'all ain't hearing me. Now, you got to know the difference between what is created and what is manifested. I want to tell you that God created the sun before he manifested it. How do you know? Because he said, let there. You can't let something, oh God Almighty, that's not already there. Oh my answer. Hallelujah. When you knock on somebody's door, you say, let me in. That means I'm already here. He said, let there be light. The light was already there, but it had been concealed. I come to tell you, you got to call it forth, because this is the year of manifestation. Call your money. Call your money forth. Your breakthrough. Call it. Call it. Call it. Call it. Call it for. Call it for. Whatever you need, call it for. Oh God. Every time we gather, miracles, signs, and wonders. I said every time we gather, miracles, signs, and wonders. Ah, yes. Oh, My Savior, my Savior, my God. We're going to move on here. But I just want to set the atmosphere for whatever else God intends to do before we leave. Before you take your seat, somebody shout, worthy! Now sit down. Sit down. God bless you. Because some of you don't even know what you just said. Look at somebody and tell them, when I said worthy, I was saying worth it. That if I had to go through it again, he's worthy, and it was worth it. My God, here today. Well, I'm grateful to be in the house of the Lord. Happy to be in the presence of God. And I'm overjoyed to mingle my voice with those who are the sanctified. As soon as you get it, tap in. As soon as you recognize, just tap on in. As soon as you discover what time it is, just tap on in. We'll go with you. I promise you, you won't dance by yourself. Bless your hearts. I'm telling you. How many know there are no announcements regarding new seasons? They're only indications. Nobody's got billboards around the city telling you it's spring now, it's summer now. There are no alerts on your devices telling you when seasons change. They're just indications. Look at somebody and tell them, if you look around and can pick up in the spirit, you ought to have discerned that the season has changed. Oh, namasa. Thank you. Now, if you respond back to me and say, Pastor Rogers, it's still cold outside, then I know you haven't tapped in yet. Touch your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, he's not talking about weather. He's talking about seasons. I don't care what the temperature is. Your season has just changed. Somebody got it. Somebody got it. Somebody got it. Somebody got it. Oh yeah, somebody got it. Not the weather. Not the weather. But your season. Your season has changed. Those of you that are watching me at home, oh God. Oh God, today. I gotta let you out of here. In Jesus' name, but I'm telling you, church, you can't go after God and not expect Him to do exceeding and abundantly above all you ask or think. Touch somebody and tell them, neighbor, if you push a little bit, God will push you all the way. If you make the slightest effort, you hear me? To break out of the box, God said, I'm going to do wonders. I'm going to show you miracles, signs, and wonders. We better quit here. For thine, let me say, is the kingdom and the in His presence. And I hear the Holy Spirit say, I will not allow you to sit in my presence unaffected. I will never allow you to be in my company without being impressed upon by my presence. And so we're grateful to God today. Grateful to be alive. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we let Him know that His Spirit is welcomed in this place? Amen. Hallelujah. More than anybody else, I'm glad to see y'all, but I am so happy that the Holy Spirit is in this place. Glory to God. Thank God for those of you present here today, and we want to bless God for those of our streaming congregation. Amen. Let's bless God for them in Jesus' name. From all over the country and parts of the world, we greet you in Jesus' name. Yes, God. Introduced to this song written by Carol Cimbala, who is she and her husband pastor Brooklyn Tabernacle in New York, and God bless the sainted memory of Mamie Elizabeth Williams. Who in 1984, and before probably not too many people in the body of Christ knew, introduced me to this divine concept known as praise and worship. And I just told her that while I accepted what she was showing me, it had to fit my culture. I'm not Jewish. You know what I'm saying? Don't clap on the 1 and 3. I clap on the 2 and 4. You know, I don't dance like this. Well, you know, I don't do that. I go like this. So I said, as long as I can make it palatable to my culture. This is one of the songs that we both discovered. And then I said, it ain't mine yet.
All right.
So it came to me. I said, Jesus.
Jesus, I'm loving you more.
Jesus.
Jesus.
You're so sweet.
Sweet.
Lord Jesus.
Jesus. I'm loving you more.
Jesus.
Jesus.
I'm
loving you more.
Yes.
Yes. I'm loving you more. I'm loving you more.
We were standing in front of the old Tidewater Bible Way Temple on that upright piano. And it fills my heart to think about where God brought us from and so many little and great things were birthed from the altar of that sanctuary. You know. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. F minor, that's that. You know. And so she would sing, and so Mamie would say, Pastor, let's sing this. She'd say, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord on the earth. I said, ho, 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 ho. You ready, Darius? Give me the. Now, let's try this. Sing unto the Lord. Help.
A new song.
Sing unto the
sing
Lord.
Sing unto the Lord.
Heart
of
the earth.
Earth.
Sing unto the Lord.
Sing unto the Lord. A new song.
Sing unto
the Lord. Heart
of
the earth.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now, you see what I mean now? Yeah. You got to make it your own. I had some mothers in Zion. I had to let them know, don't worry about it. We ain't straying too far. Amen. You know, you can still clap like you used to clap and sway a little bit. Come on, say amen. Here we go like this. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him. Help me say,
I will celebrate.
Sing
unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song.
Say it again.
I will celebrate.
Sing unto the Lord.
I will sing to him a new song.
God bless you. God bless you. Amen. We're gonna have a night of praise and worship with Pastor Rogers. We're going to have a night of praise and worship with Pastor Rogers. And if y'all push me, we might record it in Jesus' name. I have Dr. Britton friends all over the country that want me to delve back into the treasure of my musical gifting and pull out one more musical selection. The last time I recorded, they were doing compact discs. So y'all pray, because you know, if I don't see some reels going, then I don't think I'm recording. I got to see something going. See, they don't know nothing about that pack. I got to see something going. I got to see a machine about as big as this podium. Now people got laptops walking around talking about they in the studio. What studio? Studio was a building. It's got all of the acoustic, big boom mics hanging down. They had booths. You would go into the booth that was soundproof. But God is good, isn't he? We thank God for what he's done. Give God praise for this wonderful praise team. Well, the time is far spent. Pray my strength in the Lord. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, has God got a word for you? And those of you that have the kingdom's constitution, your holy Bibles, I am now 7 minutes to what should be the benediction. And I'm not sure if I'm capable of preaching a 7-minute message, but let's see what the Spirit says. If it takes a little longer, how many know when God speaks, everybody ought to listen? Would you navigate your way into the book of First Chronicles? Want to honor all of our pastors. Thank you, Pastor Darby, for all that you do. I want to thank God for Pastor McCray, who has faithful man of God, who has just gone through the veil of sorrow, having lost his mother, and we're believing that God will continue to sustain that family in the state of Michigan. It is the book of First Chronicles that you navigate your way to the 4th chapter of the book of Chronicles. First Chronicles chapter 4. I want you not to allow the familiarity of the text to cause you to miss what God wants to say, but open your hearts to what the Spirit says. I was so impressed, Lady Lorraine, on yesterday, because I got this message while I was ministering to the women of God. And I rushed out of here and went home so I could hear all the Spirit had to say. And I smelled something that was smelled fairly good. And I missed my lunch. Didn't get a plate from the women. And so y'all pray that my fast will have shown up in the message. Beginning at verse number 9, your Bible should read like this. And Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my coast, that thy hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, that it may not grieve me. And God granted him that which he requested. Thank you. You may be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and my sisters, the prophetic word to you from the Lord that needs to prophetically be declared by you. I want to speak from the subject. I'm about to blow up. Touch your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, this year I'm about to blow up. You didn't say it. A enough to convince me, but if you just find somebody that might not be jealous of what you got to say, look at them again and say, neighbor, did you hear what I said? I'm about to blow up. Sand is cheap. You can go to any beach and get your hands on sand for free. Doesn't cost you anything. Just go to the beach and you have sand accessible to you for free. However, if you put that sand in a bag, if you put it on a playground, it now has a cost. If you take that same sand and glue it to paper so that it now becomes sand paper, what was free now has a price to it. If you take that sand and heat it, send it through a process, mingle it with a computer chip, it is now worth hundreds of dollars. Hear me when I say, if it's on the beach, it's free. Because out there on the beach, people lay on it, step on it, and it gets watered down. In essence, value changes when there is purpose. Our value changes when we are taken out of the common, the familiar, and the ordinary. Help me preach this message. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, God's about to take you out of the familiar, out of the common, and out of the ordinary. Because as long as you're in the familiar, you're going to get laid on, stepped on, watered down. Check it out for free. But your value changes as your purpose changes. Or you'll get laid on, stepped on, and watered down for nothing. I come to tell you, God has kept you alive this year to shift you into divine purpose. But you must be willing to divorce yourself from the mundane and the ordinary, because the ordinary just won't do. And so this character before us, known to us as Jabez, his name is only mentioned once in Holy Writ. The only other time you'll hear that name is when it refers to a place. This is not the place, Jabez, we're talking about. This is the person. Jabez is mentioned in the backdrop of a very significant time in the lives of God's people, because now here they are, along with the edict of Cyrus, king of Persia, releasing them from the bondage of Babylonian captivity back to Jerusalem. But you must understand, beloved, that the people that are being released back to Jerusalem are not the same people who were taken captive in Babylon. For these people now are captivity babies. All they know is what they have experienced. They don't know God to having opened the Red Sea. They don't know that God had brought them into the land of Canaan. All they know is that I was born in captivity, and all I know is slavery. And now, by the hand of God upon Cyrus, king of Persia, they are being released now to reconnect to the normality of their lives, and moreover, to reconnect with their God. But they are having a struggle with both, because they don't know how, as it were, to transition into any normal life, because since birth, life has never been normal. And then there's even a greater struggle trying to re-engage God, because it was God that put their parents in bondage. And so here we have the backdrop of all that God is doing. And here are these people released. And the Bible says when they are released, Mother Shields, back to Jerusalem, that they don't start off with trying to secure their homes and domiciles. Their first assignment is that they restore the temple. That's what they built first, because they're operating from the principle, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Look at your neighbor and tell them, first things first. And so the Bible shares that Chronicles, which really was originally one book and not two, it starts off and begins with a lengthy genealogy. And it's amazing that this anonymous writer, as it were, starts off the genealogy with Adam. Read it when you get home, because he wants Israel to know that not only are you connected to Abraham, but before Abraham, you're connected to Adam. And Adam was made in the image of God. And so, in essence, the writer is trying to tell them, you are the sons, are the progenitors and the inheritors of the things of God. And the Bible says, smack dab in the middle of the genealogies comes this oddball character named Jabez. Oh my, the Bible says that it was the writer's intent to stick him right in the middle. You'll never hear his name mentioned again in scripture. And the intent of the writer is to show the rest of the nation that God will put a good ending on a bad beginning. If I could preach for two more minutes to tell somebody, you might as well perk up in here and lose that attitude of depression and free yourself from feeling sorry, because the end will be better than your beginning. I hear the Bible say, my God, tell somebody, it only gets better here. I want you to understand that when we look at this text, it shares with us something. It says that Jabez was more honorable than all of his brethren, and his mother called him Jabez, saying, I have bore him, God, with sorrow, and that's why she named him name Jabez, and he prays and asks God for a 4-point request. And the Bible goes on to say that God granted him that which he requested. I want you to take more than a cursory glance at the verse, because if you look closely, it seems as if the writer puts the conclusion where the introduction belongs. Did you hear what I'm saying? Ordinarily, it should read like this. And she called his name Jabez, saying, I have bore him in sorrow. And he prayed to God and asked God, and God granted him what he requested. But the start says that he was more honorable than his brothers. Touch somebody, look at somebody, and tell them, neighbor, if the ending is at the beginning, then you ain't sweating what's in the middle. Y'all ain't helping me preach. That's why right now, at the beginning of this year, you should have been doing the Holy Ghost two-step, because you ought to be able to see all the way to December 31st and understand that whatever happens between now and then, you're going to be all right. For God has given you a hope and a future and expected. And look at somebody and tell them it's getting better all the time. Oh God, I thank you for this. Look at somebody and tell them he put the introduction at the end and the conclusion at the beginning. Can I just do a brief exegetical understanding of the text? The Bible says his name is Jabez because his mother called him this. Stating this, notice what she says. I bear him with sorrow. Now, what's ambiguous here that is cleared up in Genesis chapter 3? Because most women, according to the text in Genesis chapter 3, when the Lord is handing out penalties for sin in the garden, he turns to Eve and says, in sorrow you shall give birth to children. And most women give birth to children in sorrow. But this woman said, I bear him with sorrow. In essence, there was something external outside of the birth that was impacting her. So she named him according to what was happening to her. He had nothing to do with her sorrow. She said, I come to bear this boy with previous baggage. I don't know. And if you really look at his name, it says he that causes sorrow. I don't know whether it was an absentee father. She could have even been talking about God. She could have been talking about the devil. But whatever it was an external situation that had nothing to do with gynecological delivery. I come to tell you here that some of us are victims of somebody else's struggle, having nothing to do with what you're going through. And I want you to know, instead of this woman freeing herself from whatever the grief was, she now labels it. And every time you put a name on your pain, you relive that thing. I come to tell you, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, it ain't your bae, it ain't your boo, it ain't ain't your money, it's your mouth. You shall decree a thing and it'll come to pass. You got to learn how to use your words. Come on in here and decree what God says. For the power of life and death is in the tongue. You got to stop naming your pain. You got to stop calling stuff and free yourself from the hell that you've been through. Because every time you recall it, you bring it up again. It's like undigested food. It regurgitates itself. I need somebody here to declare no more drama. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are before. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, wake up and name what God said you ought to name. And Jabez said, that's it. And Jabez called on the name of the Lord. Jabez is the first one in the whole book of Chronicles that calls on the name of God. Look at somebody and tell him, you better call him if you want out. He called on the name of the God of Jacob. Actually, the Bible says he called on the name of the God of Israel. And Israel was Jacob, the Old Testament thug, the supplanter. And Jabez understands if God could do it for him, he can do it for me. Real quick, and let's go home. He has this four compartmentalized prayer. And it goes like this. Number one, bless me indeed. Put your Bible on your lap for a while. Put your devices down. Lift both your hands and tell them, Lord, bless me indeed. Bless me convincingly. Bless me so that there will be no error of mistake that I am blessed and highly favored. Bless me so that even my haters know I can't stand them, but I can't deny that they're blessed. Bless me so that even people that know my past say, Lord, they're crazy and I know they're off, but I know they are blessed. Bless me indeed. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, the reason you don't have what you want is because you won't ask it. You got these pseudo crazy, pseudo saints that make you believe that asking God to blow your life up is an act of pride. Well, you sit there with the twos and fuse if you want to. Look at your neighbor and tell them, I'm going for something big this year. Did you hear what I tell you? I'm going for what eyes have not seen and what ears have not heard. You stay there. And you dwell in the land of poverty if you want to. You stay there in Lodibar if you want to. But tell somebody, I'm getting ready to blow up. Did you hear what I said? He says, bless me indeed. Bless me so until there's evidence everywhere I turn that I don't have good luck. I am blessed and highly favored. I don't have good fortune. Every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, no shadow of turning. Lift those hands and say, bless me indeed. That's what I'm asking him to do. Sit there if you want to with your mouth closed. But can I tell you something? You have not because you ask not. Ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be open. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm going for something big. I'm going to ask God for it. Two, says to the Lord, enlarge my coast. Enlarge my coast. Don't eliminate the boundaries. Just expand them. Tell somebody, oh, I need my boundaries now. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, don't act like you all that say. How many know you need God to put boundaries on you? Because if he don't put boundaries on you, somebody gonna show enough get cussed out. Don't sit up here like you ain't had it in your heart and your mind, and some of you went on and said it. Look at somebody and tell them, I need God to keep boundaries. Enlarge me, but keep the boundaries around me. Because Lord, I know I'm saved, but I'm crazy. And if you don't put a boundary on me, that woman right there to work with me, I'm about to put hands on her. Oh, tell the Lord, keep a boundary around me, Lord. Come on here. I heard him say, enlarge my house. Because when you enlarge my coast, I see things differently. Watch this. There's Deacon Tony, there's Elder Miller, there's Elder Darby. This lectern from where they're sitting looks very big. But ask Deborah Wells, who's standing, Deborah Wells Dart, and ask Ray Hall, who's standing in the back, that it doesn't look as big to them back there as it does up here. Isn't it amazing that while here on the ground, everything looks big, but when you get up in the air, everything looks small. So I'm saying, God, enlarge my coast so my problems don't look so big. Enlarge my coast so what I'm dealing with, I see from a different vantage point. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I don't know about you, but I need him to enlarge my territory. Enlarge my territory, enlarge my coast, which means give me more land. And more land implies more work. My problem was idleness. I can't tell you how many folks got into crazy trouble when COVID hit. Because they was quarantined, had time on their hand. And my mama always told me, idle time is the devil's workshop. Lord, keep me busy, keep me working. Y'all ain't say nothing to me. You're looking at me funny, but touch your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, God's about to enlarge you. Come on, preach the message. Come on, I'm a wordsmith. I love words. Y'all know that. But I tried my best to coin this message another way. I couldn't, Jess. I was trying my best to come up with something a bit more profound. And the only thing, Gail, I could come up with is that I'm about to blow up. I even asked God, could you put it in the old English? Thee, thou, and thus. Whereas and wherefore? He said, no, Rogers, I'm going to say it in 21st century vernacular. I'm about to blow you and everybody attached to Kingdom Cathedral. I'm about to blow you up. I'm about to show you off to the world. I'm going to show you what a supernatural God can do with plain old ordinary people that are yielded to his will. I need somebody to lift your hands and say, yes, Lord. Tell him, enlarge my coast. And then he said, Eric Howell, he said, now, Lord, when you do these things, don't leave me. Keep your hand, my God. Keep your hand on me. I know I have a proclivity to stray, a proclivity. property to wander, because now I got more property. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. Now that I've expanded myself, and I'm not trying to say that poor people don't sin, because they do, but rich people have options. You see what I'm saying? People that don't have a whole lot of money have few options as to how and what and when they sin. Some of them can't afford to sin. Y'all ain't saying nothing to me. There are certain things that are not within a poor person's purview to acquire. But the more you get, the more temptation there is, because you got opportunity. So he says, I know I could be something else, but keep your hand on me as I'm walking through all this territory. Keep your hand on me, Lord. Oh God, even though I'm gifted, I need your anointing to make the difference. Although I'm talented, keep your hand on me so that people will know that is your anointing that supersedes my talent. I need somebody here to lift those hands and tell them, Lord, keep your hand on me. All right, let's go home. Fourth and final. Touch your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, this one is for you. Tell them, but I want to warn you, it's going to be hard. He says, keep me from evil. I thought y'all respond like that. And you're responding like that because you know what he said, but you don't know what he didn't say. He didn't say, keep evil from me. You'll get it when you get home. He said, keep me from evil, because evil's gonna always be around me. But put something in me, oh God, so I can be kept from evil. Look at your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, when I would do good, evil is always present. But yea, though I walk through the valley and the shadow of death, thou art with me. Yes, sir. Lift those hands and tell them, Lord, keep me from evil. Now notice what he says. He says, keep me from evil, that it might not grieve me. If you've been listening, Jabez's name means grief and sorrow. He's saying, God, keep me from evil so that evil doesn't make me become again what you delivered me from. Because I'm looking in the faces and even at the mirror of repeat offenders. But I'm telling God, I'm tired of making the same mistakes as I did last year. I'm ready to blow up. And if my craziness has helped me back, then keep my mind, keep my soul, keep my body. For I present my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is my reasonable service. And I choose not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of my mind, so I can prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Look at three people and tell them, you're about to blow up, you're about to blow up, you're about to. You're making me work harder than I should. Whew. Here's the shout, we go home. And God granted him that which he prayed for. Make your request known. If you're tired of it, tell God, I'm tired of it, and I want you to get rid of it. Whatever it takes. That's when I know you're tired of it. You ain't tired of it when you're gonna tell God how to do it. How many know you don't want to be well when you got your hand on the doctor's hand? Wait. No, you ain't really sick. When you sick, you roll your sleeve all the way up to your shoulder so that your body is exposed, or you pull down or pull up and tell the doctor, do what you got to do, because I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. You can't tell God how to do it. You tell him any way you do it. I want out of this struggle. I'm on out of this craziness. I'm on out of this vicious cycle. If it means you got to move people out of my life, go ahead on and move them out. Because I want to be right. I want to be saved. And I want to be whole. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, we're getting ready to leave out of here. But before we leave, this is the best news you heard all year. You are about to blow up. You're on your way to a place called success. Be thou courageous, and I will give you good success. And wherever the sole of your feet shall tread, I'm gonna give it to you. Kingdom Cathedral, this is our finest hour. Blessings, I will bless thee. Multiplying, I will multiply. As the sands of the sea, as the stars of the heaven, I dare you to tell them, give it to me, Lord. I done been through enough hell to know how to handle being blessed. I've been down long enough to appreciate a raise. Look at your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, what are you waiting for? To praise God. Don't wait for a man. Don't wait for a woman. Don't wait for a boo or a bae. Yes. Look in the mirror and say, I'm the bomb. I'm about to blow up. Say, yes. God bless you. Good afternoon. You're about to blow up. And when you blow up, everything around you will be caught in the fallout. Y'all better hear me now. Y'all don't know nothing about this because y'all too young, but the few of us over 50 know when we grew up, Iris, you remember, they make us leave school, or rather leave class, especially back in like the 60s, early 50s, and you'd have to go out in the hallway. And then sometimes they'd make you kneel up under your desk because there was always the threat of war. We were in the Cold War at that time with Russia that became the USSR. Now, you'd also see throughout the school and other public buildings this yellow and black sign. It said, Fallout Shelter. That means if the bomb fell, you'd have somewhere to go where the radiation wouldn't hit you. Touch your neighbor and tell him, but with this blow up, there are no fallout shelters. So whoever is around you, when you blow up, they gonna get blown up too. So it'd be good for you to treat me right. Cause when I blow up, you gonna blow up too. Don't be mad and don't be jealous. Don't hate, celebrate. Cause we are all about to blow up. Yes, we won't be competing. We'll be comparing. How do you like your Bentley? I love mine. How do you like your Maybach? I'm crazy about mine. Touch your neighbor, tell neighbor. The prophet came here and said you live a couple of miles down from Pastor. And some of y'all thought that was cute, but y'all don't have a clue. I'm about to blow up. So if you live anywhere near me, you're doing real good. Touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, don't wait until I blow up. Come on and magnify the Lord in me, and let us exalt his name together. Blow up in your home, blow up on your job, blow up in the schoolhouse, blow up in your family, blow up in your relationship. Say yes, say yes. Somebody clap your hands and shout, I'm about to blow up. Your career is about to blow up. I said your career is about to blow up. The Lord spoke to me prophetically. I told the saints on Wednesday night, God said, I'm going to make your passion your profession. Because some of y'all doing stuff you hate. You get up in the morning. You got to have prayer before you go up in there. Then you got to steal away on your lunch break and go to the bathroom and have prayer again. And you be watching the clock say, 449, 450, 455, 457, 459, hallelujah, 5 o'clock. But touch your neighbor and tell them, that's over now. God's gonna turn your passion into a profession. So what you love to do, you'll make millions from. Can I speak over God's people? I'm not trying to hype you. I'm trying to help you. I got up here before I even opened the Bible to try to tell you your season has changed and you're still looking at conditions that are around you. But touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, since we've been in this building worshiping God, the Lord has just turned the page. It's a new chapter in your life. Give him praise, give him glory. I know it's late, but I come to tell you one more time. I feel my daddy's spirit. You're about to blow up. Give him praise. Okay. Touch your name and tell them, I really got it. So tell them, don't be mad with me when you hear my name a whole lot this year. Tell them, prepare yourself, because a whole lot's going to be done for me this year. I tried to warn you so you wouldn't be looking at me cross-eyed. Tell somebody one more time. I'm about to blow up. Yes. Yes. All I asked him to do was bless me indeed. Enlarge my coast. Keep your hand on me. Keep me from evil. And just cause I asked him, my God, tell somebody, access granted. And can I tell y'all why Jabez and you are getting granted requests? Because God knew you'd praise him if he didn't. Tell somebody, neighbor, I've been living all this time without it. I just decided it's been long enough living my life because of somebody else's issues. Yes! I don't care if it's even your own mama. The buck stops with her. The generational curse is over. And it begins with me. They might have been an alcoholic. Yes! But I'm filled with the Holy Ghost and drunk in the Spirit. They might have been in poverty. But I'm as rich as can be. With my Savior I see, I am happy with Jesus alone. Somebody tell me to quit. Look at your neighbor, tell neighbor, get ready. You're about to blow all the way up. Everything that was trying to hurt or hinder you, touch your neighbor and tell them, and it got blown up too. Frustration, hurt, poverty, sickness, disease, divorce. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, will no longer name my pain, because after I blow up, there'll be no indication of what I've been through. That's why the thing starts off by saying that Jabez was more honorable. That's how it should have ended up, but it ended up, yes sir, the way it started. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, this is how your testimony is going to start. And they came out all right. And they were blessed 1,000 times more. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, put the blessing in front of the burden. Put the praise in front of the problem. Somebody say, it's already all right. Somebody say, it's already all right. Y'all ain't ready. Y'all ain't ready. Touch somebody and tell them, neighbor, if you push me, I'll have watch night service right now. Yes. For the Lord knows the end from the beginning. Look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, since you already know what the end's gonna be, tell them, neighbor, go ahead and praise him for what's gonna happen in the middle.
For we walk by faith and not by sight. I feel like having a preaching fit. Tell somebody it's already all right. Yeah, my house is all right. My money's all right. My relationship's all right. Yeah, it's all right. Yeah, it's all right.
I know I got y'all working here. But do me one more favor and touch your neighbor and tell him, neighbor, I'm about to send you a save the day. Ask them for what? Tell them for my blow up party. What's the date for your blow up party? Somebody shout, any day now. Just say, tell somebody, save the date, cause I'm about to blow up any day now. Give God a prayer. This ain't nothing. I'm not trying to put down the present, but this ain't nothing. Not compared with what's coming. And y'all done heard it so long until you done got desensitized. All you preachers, what's coming will be better than okay. But I come to tell you, hear the text, to give you and it, tell somebody you'll only get what you're looking for. Hallelujah. Didn't say how long you looked for it. It just said you had to keep on looking. You got to go to the mailbox every day. Because some of you, like Pastor Rogers, only check your mailbox every few days. And one time I was looking for something and had the nerve to get hot because I didn't see it. When I called the vendor, they said, have you checked the mailbox? It was sent 2 weeks ago. I said, oh. When I opened it, sure enough, he was there. I heard the angel, Michael, tell Daniel, your prayer was heard 21 days ago. I had to withstand the prince of Persia. Touch your neighbor, tell me, neighbor. That's why I know you're going to blow up. Because the Lord already heard your prayer. Yeah. And while you were praying, the answer was already on the way. I need somebody that knows I'm preaching to you to give God one moment of crazy praise. Go ahead and bless him. Go ahead and bless him. Leap, run, dance, shout. See, I need faith in here. Faith is the timer on the bomb. And the more faith you have, Ronia, the quicker the bomb detonates. Did y'all hear what I said? I'm crazy enough to believe, despite what doctors say, Fauci, CDC, and the World Health Organization, I'm crazy enough to believe, just to show his power, God can blow up COVID-19. But we gotta praise him like we wanted to. Some of y'all ain't prayed. Y'all just told God, keep us from dying. But I'm crazy enough to tell him, take it away. Take it away. Take it away. And God granted his request. God. Yes.
God bless you, and thanks for viewing. Would you consider partnering with us with a financial contribution? We have three ways that you can give. Cash App, $KingdomCathedralVA, or you can go to our website, www.kingdomcathedral.org. And the third way, you can write us, Kingdom Cathedral, 3820 Stone Shore Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23452.